Hey everyone, I'm Marc Laliberte, Security Operations Manager at WatchGuard Technologies and Manager of our Threat Research Team, what we call the WatchGuard Threat Lab. Thanks for hopping on to Security Insights today, where we'll be talking about fileless malware, how it works, why attackers are using it, and ending with some defensive tips to keep you and your system safe from this highly evasive threat. But before we start talking about fileless malware, let's just chat about malware in general. What is it? Well, malware is malicious software. It's a malicious program or code that does some form of harm once it's executed on your system. It's a file that you unknowingly download from the internet, save from an email attachment, or have dropped on your system by some other malware stager from a previous infection. The bottom line is it gets saved to your storage device, your hard drive, your solid state drive, your flash card, whatever. And because it gets saved to your hard drive, it's actually comparatively easy to identify, detect, and remediate, even by traditional endpoint protection tool suites. Because those tools are constantly scanning downloaded files, constantly re-scanning files saved to your storage device using updated signatures, contextual engines, heuristics, whatever. The bottom line is, eventually they will catch that threat and delete it. And deleting it is often all it takes to clean up these traditional malware infections. You know, sometimes you have to go in and clean up registry entries or anything else that's touched, but in general, if you delete that malware file, you've cleaned up that malware infection. Now, fileless malware, on the other hand, is a completely different story. At no point in time does it ever save anything to your hard drive or storage device on your system, and this makes it significantly more difficult to detect. Instead, it runs entirely in memory, often injecting itself into the memory of another existing legitimate process on your system. And from there, it uses techniques like living off the land techniques, abusing tools built into your operating system to carry out all of its malicious actions. Now, it's a bit of a misnomer. It often starts with a file, typically in the form of an office document. But how it differs from traditional malware is as soon as that office document runs and runs the macros or kicks off the exploit inside of it, everything else runs just in memory. It doesn't care what happens to that original office document. It's got ways to stay persistent on the system, to do every single form of malicious action at once without downloading anything else onto that host. Now, the other form of fileless malware is actually entirely fileless. Often this style of attack goes after a vulnerability in an application, exploits that to gain code execution, and then pivots from there and hides in, again, the memory locations of other processes. Now, fileless malware has been around for quite some time. There's been memory resident viruses since the 80s. Code Red and SQL Slammer were technically fileless network worms in the 2000s, but these living off the land evolutions from the past few years are really where we're seeing cyber threat actors focus their time and attention because they are so effective. They're using these toolkits like PowerSploit and PowerWare, which were originally designed for white hat hackers, legitimate penetration testers, but because of their efficacy, these cyber criminals are taking these off-the-shelf tools now and using them to launch highly evasive and devastating attacks. Their flavor of the month now are DLL and memory injection, where basically they compromise existing processes and use that to evade endpoint protection tool suites. We see them again using legitimate Windows tools like PowerShell and NetSH, basically these tools and systems built into your host that again gives them everything they need in order to launch anything from a crypto miner to a ransomware infection on the endpoint. And we often see them attached to zero-day exploits as well, going after unpatched vulnerabilities in hosts to again start that initial infection and then from there never have to download anything onto that endpoint. They really started to pick up in 2016, and as you'll see in a second, they've only skyrocketed from there. And again, it's a bit of a misnomer. We often see them start with a file, like an office document, but again, as soon as that runs, everything else resides in memory, and it's really difficult to block that style of attack without just straight up blocking a whole bunch of legitimate applications. Now, if you followed any of our recent internet security reports, you probably remember from quarter four of 2020, where we discussed the 888% increase in script-based threats, so fileless malware and living off the land attacks, from 2019 through the end of 2020. And now, just in the first half of this year, we've seen almost our 80% of our total 2020 volume, again, in just the first half of 2021. Basically, if it remains at this pace, Fileless Malware is going to surpass even last year's massive increase in this year as well. And again, that's fueled by these toolkits like PowerSploit and Powerware that make it easy for even low-skilled attackers to carry out these highly evasive and devastating attacks. Some of the forms that we've seen in recent years involve attacks abusing things like DDE, where if you're not familiar with dynamic data execution, a great example of it legitimately used is if you've ever copied and pasted an Excel spreadsheet into a Word document, you'll notice you can update that Excel spreadsheet and it also updates the Word document version of that table too. That's using DDE to facilitate that communication. But it's really robust in what it can actually do. In fact, you can use DDE to launch other applications. So in this case, command prompt to then launch another application like calculator.exe as a proof of concept. Or if you're a threat actor, to launch PowerShell and then use that elevated PowerShell toolkit to then download a script and then execute that. And the reason attackers have pivoted to DDE from things like macro-based malware is because if you've ever opened up a macro document recently, you'll notice that big yellow ribbon at the top that says security warning. This has macros enabled. Are you sure you want to enable this? And even to like untrained users, they recognize that there's probably some security considerations if they accidentally or intentionally hit enable on that little button at the top. With DDE though, you don't get that. If you open up one of these documents, you just get this little gray window here that says, this document contains links that may refer to other files. Do you want to update this document with data from those linked files? And to an untrained user, if I see that, I just think, oh, it looks like Word kind of crapped out, but you know, I want to gain access to this, so yes. And if you hit yes, that is enough to allow DDE to execute, load up something like PowerShell, download a script from the internet, and then use that to start their evasive fileless malware attack. We've seen more sophisticated examples as well too. Recently, we onboarded a new organization to our endpoint protection and endpoint detection and response tool set. And during that onboarding, we actually identified an existing infection and went back to investigate how this actually occurred. And what it boiled down to was it started with a compromised set of credentials for this organization's SQL database server, which on its own is bad enough. Like if you've got these credentials, potentially you can dump the entire database and steal all that data and then maybe leverage that and extort them for a ransom on the underground or just sell it to some other organization. But what the attacker did in this case was they used those credentials to then enable this XP command shell procedure, which basically lets you run commands on the underlying Windows operating system. Then using that access, they copied PowerShell.exe to the temp directory as a form of evasion. Maybe that you had a endpoint protection suite that was looking for PowerShell running on a SQL server as a potential red flag. Then they used PowerShell to download this obfuscated dropper, which when we deobfuscate it, you can see it's pretty simple what it's doing. It sends out a GET request and downloads this text file, nc.txt. It decodes it, and then it executes it on the host. And again, while even though it's downloading it, it's not actually saving it on the host. All of this is just in memory. There's no file being created for endpoint protection to scan and identify as malicious in this case. When we look at that decoded text file, it's actually a slightly modified version of PowerSploit's reflective injection module, which at a high level, it takes an embedded piece of malware, embedded shell code, injects it into the memory of another process running on the system, and then executes it. And in this case, for this organization, they got lucky. It was just a crypto miner, which a crypto miner on your database server is still pretty bad. It's going to siphon off a lot of resources from that server, but it could have been a lot worse with ransomware, as we're seeing more commonly used in this style of attack. But again, this entire thing existed without ever saving a file onto this system's storage device. It ran entirely in memory, which makes it really difficult to detect. So pausing, how do you detect this style of attack? And really, it boils down to what we've been saying for the last few years, and that's a layered approach to security. There's no single thing that you can turn on or set up or install that's going to protect you from every single threat that's out there. So you need to make sure that you're deploying multiple layers of security from the perimeter down to the endpoint with user training in between in order to catch these more evasive threats. Now, when it comes to the technical controls for fileless malware, start with intrusion prevention systems. So use a tool set that can look for attempted exploits of vulnerabilities in applications that you use. That can stop a lot of these fileless threats that will exploit a flaw and then use that foothold to then launch the rest of the attack. But that's not enough on its own. You also need to make sure you've got layers of anti-malware. And when we say anti-malware, we mean proactive anti-malware. While signature-based anti-malware engines have a place, they're really good at quickly and efficiently identifying the noise. You need proactive engines instead that will use machine learning models to predict whether a file is bad or good, or more preferably a cloud sandbox to actually detonate a file, watch its behaviors, and then come up with a definitive thumbs up or thumbs down on whether it's good or bad. Because at the end of the day, malware is malicious software. It's gonna do something bad, and if you can see its behaviors, you can stop it from executing on the actual endpoint in that case. And then on another layer of security, not just endpoint protection, but also endpoint detection and response to catch anything that potentially slipped through your defensive tools. And if you're confused about the differences between EPP and EDR, really it boils down to pre-execution and post-execution. EPP is all about stopping threats from running on a system. So it starts with signatures and contextual rules to quickly identify known threats and those suspicious code structures and stop them from ever running on the endpoint. Even during attempted execution, it can look at the context and make a decision on if it's going to allow that or not. Like, you can't just block command.exe on Windows without a whole lot of collateral damage to legitimate uses on that system. But you can watch command.exe execute, see that it's loading up PowerShell, see that it's now disabling the anti-malware scan interface on Windows, and that it's downloading and deobfuscating this script and then trying to run that. And hopefully that's enough red flags then to block that action before it's able to complete execution. EDR, on the other hand, is all about post-execution. So it's looking at memory inspection. It's looking for in-memory injections and attempted exploits against applications that are already running on your system and new ones that get spun up. It's all about threat hunting across an organization to correlate and identify suspicious activity and respond to it before it becomes a major event. Because these days, most cyber threats are multi-staged instead of that quick, you know, one and done, installed, run, execute right there. These days, there's some dwell time. They're going to use their access to identify your most critical resources and elevate their levels of access, try and exfiltrate data out of your network before that coup de grace or ransomware attack on the end of it. Basically, you've got time where if you've got the right endpoint detection response tools deployed across your whole organization, you can catch it after that initial bad event before it turns into this devastating attack. If you take nothing else away from this, just remember there's no silver bullet to security, and you need to make sure that you've got a layered approach from the perimeter down to the endpoint with user training all throughout it as well to catch these multi-stage and evasive threats, especially when it comes to fileless malware.